Okay, so thank you very much for inviting me to give this talk. Thanks to everybody, Dimitri, and of course the rest of you for taking the time. I know it's a bit late for you, but I hope you will find this topic interesting. So what I'm going to discuss is, and I hope you can all see me, and also you can see my slides. I'm going to discuss a bit the celestial CFT correlators, and I'm going to try to, depending on time, to discuss our final work, our last, most recent work on conformal block decomposition. So this is a work based in on a series of papers starting back in 2019 with my collaborators, Wei Fan, Thomas Taylor, Stefan Stieberger, and Bin Chu. Went through a series of various topics, let's say, on this story. And I will try to cover a substantial amount of that. So let me start first by asking, why do we want to study celestial CFT? Why? So one of the main developments in the past few years has been the discovery that asymptotically flat space times, they have a much larger symmetry at null infinity than the Poincaré one. This has been known for quite some time, is called the BMS symmetry, or Bonti, Mercer, and Zaks. Where, except from Lorentz transformations and ordinary translations, you have a much larger set of transformations that are called super translations. Okay, so that was the original story. And then later in 2009, Barnick and Trossard demonstrated that on top of this BMS symmetry, you can extend it, and actually the Lorentz group can become the full Virage, except from having global conformal transformations that correspond to the Lorentz group, you have also local conformal transformations. So actually you can extend the symmetry group to Virajoro. So Virajoro plus super translations is what we call the extended BMS symmetry. So of course, once Virajoro pops out, or in general, whenever the conformal group pops out, you start thinking about the conformal field theory. Okay. Also, recently there has been a lot of renewed interest in what we call soft theorems in four-dimensional quantum field theory. So the soft behavior of scattering amplitudes and some statements about locality, they always uniquely fix the S matrix, at least at the three level for Gauss theorem gravity. And it turns out that these asymptotic symmetries can be mapped actually into what we call in ward identities of this formulation in terms of what we call celestial CFT. So there's a relation between the soft theorems in four dimension theory and the representation on this theory that we call celestial CFT. But probably one of the main motivations, as this story goes, is flat space time holography. Well, we all know that the usual holographic picture is formulated in a gravity theory in a curved background, which, and the boundary theory is a quantum field theory on the boundary of this space-time. But of course, we all know that approximately we live in a flat space-time. So we would like to have a similar holographic description for flat space-time. And since what we're discussing here is S matrix and of flat space time, just normal Minkowski, and we see that already kind of a conformal field theory picture emerges, we think that this might be the connection we want to make between the bulk space time and the boundary. So this is what we would call flat space time holography. So it's quite interesting. Other interesting developments that have appeared different stories, like the story between gauge interactions that can be recast as a, I'm sorry, gravity interactions that can be recast as a double copy of gauge interactions. And this goes back, of course, to string theory by the well-known KLT relations, but recently they have been extended into relations between just gauge theory amplitudes and gravity amplitudes. And well, if you go in a conformal field theory in two dimensions, if you have a symmetry, a Kac-Moody symmetry, there are similar constructions, namely the Sugawara construction that allows you, for example, to construct the energy momentum tensor of the theory from the current algebra. So there are similar stories that we will see that can, there's some connection between probably between these two ideas. And of course, At the end, again, in the Gates theory side, or gravity field theory side, I should say, you have recursion relations like BCFW, CHY, that basically allow you to glue on cell amplitudes and reproduce, let's say, from 2-3 point functions, you get a 4 point function and so on. In conformal field theories, this is very well known for many years. What you do is you use the operator product expansion and you have a similar procedure and you have very strong constraints that come from the operator product expansion, namely the crossing symmetry. So this, all the space-time story here seems somehow to be related to what we want to describe. So how does a story start? Well, I'm just going to say very few things about the geometric aspect. I'm going to be interested more about the quantum theory one. So we can take Flat-Minkowski spacetime, and we write in Bondi coordinates. So this is an null coordinate, the radial, and two coordinates, z and z bar, that actually parameterize a celestial sphere. And if you take R to go to infinity, your spacetime topologically becomes a sphere times R. R is the null time direction. And you can see here a Penrose diagram that shows what is happening if we conformally compactify our spacetime. This U is this null coordinate that runs like that. Massless particles leave from the, and also U is here, this is the null past infinity. This is the null future infinity. So massless particles that travel at 45 degrees, leaving from this region, let's say from a point here, and they go right here. So they leave from some point of the celestial sphere. Well, this celestial sphere here in the past. So I saw it as a circle because I cannot draw a bigger, a more dimensional object. So think of it, this is the celestial sphere. This is ZZ bar, parameterizes this circle as you see it here. The radial direction is like that. And even particle leaves from here massless, it will travel and end up somewhere at the future null infinity. So at some point of the celestial sphere of future null infinity. Massive particles, they leave from these points here and they travel and they end up here. These are basically the massive particles. I'm not going to discuss too much here, but they're not, they don't end up, they call it the, it's called J plus. Plus null infinity. So massless particles can live from anywhere in the past and end up somewhere in the future here. So why is this interesting? Well, this is exactly what we do in an S matrix. We define some initial data, we scatter particles, we send them in, and then we collect them somewhere at the future infinity. So pretty much seems to be kind of a story that can be related to the S matrix. Okay, so what's our idea now? Basic idea, I said I'm not gonna say much about geometry. The basic idea is the following. We basically can recast amplitudes, space-time amplitudes in the form of conformal correlators of primary fields on the celestial sphere. What do we have? In four dimensions, amplitudes, they involve asymptotic wave functions, which transform simply under space-time translations. These are the plane wave fields. And they have manifest translation symmetry. Okay. So they describe actually any scattering process describes a transition between momentum eigenstates and they're computed using the standard Feynman rules. And they depend on the momentum, the external states and polarizations. Now we will see that there's a map that allows you to take this picture here and map it to basically, this will be a four-dimensional space-time amplitude, as I show here, I think a three-point function, okay? And basically, there is a way to transform from this to a new basis that basically the scattering amplitude takes the form of a conformal correlator of primary fields, okay? The energies of the particles are mapped to the conformal dimensions. I show them here as H and H bar, so you have H and H bar. Holomorphic and anti-holomorphic. So they map actually to H plus H bar for each particle. So the energy is mapped to conformal dimensions of primary fields. And the, basically, this here, this Z, in the space-time picture corresponds to the direction towards which the master's particle is pointing asymptotically in the celestial sphere. So it's telling you where the master's particle will end up on the celestial sphere, let's say at future infinity. And this, in this picture, is mapped to the position of the operators on the celestial sphere. So you get a form, let's say schematically like that. The denominators are fixed completely by conformal symmetry. Now, how does a conformal symmetry emerge? In space-time, you have Lorentz symmetry, SO1, 3, which is isomorphic to SL2C modulus Z2, if I remember correctly. And this symmetry here in this picture translates into the global conformal symmetry on the celestial sphere. So when you get this correlator here, these are fixed completely by conformal invariants. The information that is relevant to the specific theory you're studying is the coupling constant here, G. I wrote the G here, normally has some indices, G, I, J, K. It's more complex than just schematically here. So, and the important thing about conformal field theory in two dimensions is that basically this structure, as I said here, is completely determined by conformal invariants, and pretty much also, if you know the operator product expansion that we'll discuss soon, you can get the theory, not just a three-point function, but any higher point function, just by knowing the OPE. So we shall see later that the global conformal group is getting enhanced to the full local conformal group. So general conformal transformations, I'm sorry, local conformal transformations of this type. So this is our motivation. It seems that we can go from one to another. So how do we go from one basis to another?
Sorry, can I ask one thing?
Sure.
So as I understand here, you have massless particles. And as far as I know, for massless particles with real momenta, three points, the scattering is trivial, right?
Yeah.
How do you go around this?
No, we haven't gone around it. That's a very good observation. I put 3 points just not to fill in too much on the slide. The three-point function, function indeed is zero. Okay. Mm-hmm. The way to go around is to go to 2.2 signature, just like you do in BCFW. Then you can write down a three-point function that is not zero. So it's exactly what you do in BCFW. Now, it is one of our problems, actually, how to put this thing in the CFT setup, because in the CFT setup, you would like to have the three-point function not to be zero, obviously. If you consider the three-point function of gluons, of massless particles, or gravitons, indeed, the three-point function in the four dimensions in signature 1.3 is zero. So indeed, you would find naively a CFT result that is zero. We will see towards the end that there seem to be more operators than just the gluons. Okay, that's what our conformal block expansion kind of reveals. So, but it is still an open problem. How exactly to bring this, what happens exactly in the three-point function of the CFT? Naively zero. If you want to avoid it, you go to 2.2 signature and then you can work there. And there's been some recent work along this direction.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, thank you.
Clear? Okay, so what do we do now? We start from the momentum basis. This is a massless particle. We assume this is the energy, and this is a null vector, which is parameterized by the celestial sphere coordinates, Z and Z bar. And the way to transition from the basis of plane waves to the basis of what we call conformal primary wave functions that have good conformal, they have good transformations under the global conformal group is the Mellin transform. So we do this Mellin transform. Now here, so that's a state, a Mellin transform on states. You can look directly in wave functions. So if this is, let's say, and I will show an example rather. So if this is, let's say, a plane wave, you do the Mellin transform of a plane wave, it turns out that what you get here is an object that transforms nicely under conformal, global conformal transformations. Okay. The interesting thing is that the dimensions here, they are 1 plus I lambda. That's what we call the principal continuous series. And lambda is a real number. And you see, of course, dimensions are complex, but again, remember that we're talking about the celestial sphere that's completely Euclidean. Okay. Now, this, well, how is this conformal primary wave functions described? Described by a point Z on the celestial sphere. And that's basically the point where the massless particle enters if it's coming in or exits the celestial sphere if it's coming out. And the Lorentz quantum numbers, the L2C quantum numbers we have are H and H bar. So the dimension, of course, I'm gonna show it in the next slide, is basically H plus H bar, okay? We can have spin also. Here I kind of like restricted to a case of a scalar. See, I cannot include any spin. Let's look at a simple example. Scalar plane wave, a scalar particle. We can make the Mellin transform. You get a function like that. And you can check, of course, that this solves the four-dimensional Klein-Gordon equation because nothing else but superposition of plane waves. Okay, we have to put a plus or minus for in or out states. And this is it's in order to avoid the singularity when Qx becomes zero. Okay, it looks like the Feynman perspective. So what do we have in the one basis? Plane waves are parameterized, of course, this is the wave function, and they have these labels, p mu, where, of course, we assume massless particles on set. So basically, there are three free parameters, okay, because p squared has to be equal to zero. Going to the new basis, we have the conformal primary wave functions. We get them from the Mellin transform, and the labels we have are the conformal weight, 1 plus I lambda, and the position of the celestial sphere. Again, here we're talking about the scalar. If you apply a Lorentz transformation on this conformal primary wave function, it transforms exactly like a primary field, okay? And a quasi-primary, I should say, because not to be confused, because primary fields usually in Virasoro mean something more here. Just think global. We're still discussing global conformal transformations, SL2C. We can do the same thing for a gauge boson. We have a polarization and plane wave. You do the same story. You have two helicities, okay? And now helicities are mapped to two-dimensional spins. So you have a plus or minus helicity. Now you have plus or minus one spin. Again, dimension and the position of the celestial sphere. The form, starting from the plane wave basis and going here, is very similar to the scalar, of course, just the polarization tensor here. Again, there are some issues about how to write something that's gauge invariant. So this is, let's say, what's called a gauge representative. Of the conformal primary wave functions. The form is a bit more general. So this is the form that this DLQ take. So these are the polarization tensors. You can check that these are standard polarization tensors that you can use, plus and minus helicity polarization tensor for the gluon, let's say, or gauge boson. You can do the same thing for gravitons. So what's now our holographic picture? Because we're going holography and say, let's say, well, what do we have in mind? So in momentum basis, we have plane waves with this momenta. In conformal basis, we want to map these conformal primary wave functions to operators on what we call celestial CFT. The operators will be labeled by the conformal weights H and H bar. H plus H bar will be the dimension, the difference will give you the spin, or you can invert the relation. And based on our discussion so far, these operators here will transform as quasi-primers or global conformal primers. Okay. And basically that's a holographic picture. So this right now I just dealt with free particles. So we want to generalize this thing now in scattering situations, situation that we have a scattering. Okay. So what we would do? Well, something very similar. We use the spin or helicity basis for this story here. We take any space-time amplitude here. This is two going to n minus two. So it's an n particle scattering in general here. We express everything in terms of spin or helicity formalism because it's easier, it makes explicit the energies here and leaves these differences of the positions. I mean, of the Zi and Zj, which of course, as I told you, they parameterize the direction and along which the particle is moving in four dimensions. And then we take Mel transform of this amplitude. So we Mel transform over the energies. And the statement is the following. The Mel transform of this amplitude, which is this guy here, we use this A tilde here. So we take the Mel transform of the full space-time amplitude. It's holographically dual, that's our idea, to the correlator or the corresponding operators that have dimensions delta and j. Delta are given, as you said, from the Mel transform, and j's are, well, basically whatever is the spin, or if you prefer the helicity of the gluon, is telling you what's going to be the spin of the corresponding operator. So that's our story. Okay, that's our stuff. So we want to discuss to see what's happening with this correlator. Because okay, right now we just took an amplitude, we convert to a correlator, we'd like to see what's happened. Do we have OPEs? What kind of other symmetries we might have? We'll see. Okay. So typical situation, the 4-point gluon amplitude, because there are some novel features here, it's not so simple. So this is the Mel transform of the 4-point MHV amplitude, the only non-vanishing one. Once you do the Mel transform, you get a form like that. So let me explain that. These are Zij's, so differences of the positions of the operators, holographically. This form is dictated completely by conformal covariance. So it is required in order for the amplitude, I mean, right here, for this guy here, to transform covariantly under conformal global conformal transformations. Then, just like any 4-point function, you can have a function, this whole thing can be multiplied by a function of the conformal invariant cross ratio. This combination here is conformal invariant. An SL2R transformation doesn't change. What you find here is this form, okay, which is specific to the theory, obviously, because that's completely specified by the theory, but you find some novel features. The first novel feature is that here, there's a delta function, which is very much unlike what you get in standard conformal field theories, that tells you basically that R should be equal to R bar. So this R should be real. This basically tells you that the four points should lie on a circle on the celestial sphere, and it's a consequence of the conservation of momentum. So this is definitely something you don't find, and it's actually a bit of an issue. That's why you will see later we'll do a trick to kind of get rid of it, because it's very difficult to try to do from here some kind of analysis because of this delta function you don't find usually in conformal theory. This delta function constrains the dimensions of the operators, okay? Now, this is kind of special for gauge theory because basically we have conformal invariance at three level. For example, if you go to string amplitudes, you're not gonna find it. You're not gonna find the delta function. But think of it as a selection rule. It tells you which dimensions are allowed in this scattering process. Okay, so this is not such a big problem. And if you go to higher point functions, which involve Gaussian hypergeometric functions, so you take the Mel transform of the 5-point function, you actually, you don't get this thing. So this novelty of the four dimensions. And as I said, if you include string theory, you're not gonna have this delta function anymore. You get something else, which I'm not gonna discuss here because there's not much time. Important thing, this R here, depending on its value here, I'm showing what is called the S channel, four-dimensional S channel. It corresponds to the scattering, for example, if R is bigger than one, this corresponds to the scattering 1, 2, goes to 3, 4, or vice versa. The other channels are given by different regions of this R, okay? So depending on who is incoming and who is outgoing, you have a different region where this R can lie. Remember that R, because of this constraint, is real. So, and these are the conformal dimensions. I'm left and right for the various gluons. This is, for example, the minus gluon. You can say H minus H bar is minus one, etc. Okay, so this is a 4-point function. Okay, so what do we wanna do now? We get some correlators. Looks like a conformal theory correlators. We're going to do some work. We wanna see first, okay, except from gluon operators, I mean states that come from gluons. Maybe there are more. We'll see probably yes. want to see what is the equivalent of Pareto product expansion in this story. And we want to discuss, of course, a very important tensor, the energy momentum tensor, and see if we can get the algebra of the symmetries of the theory. So let's see what are the symmetries. And then what I'm going to try to discuss here in time, well, the next thing you would try to do would be radial quantization on the conformal field theory. Just try to follow a textbook conformal field theory and see what you can get. And conformal block expansion, how we can take this four-point function, let's say, and analyze it in conformal blocks that give you information of what states are exchanged, let's say, at this CFT between two operators and other two operators. Important, I think, crossing symmetry, that's work in progress. How crossing symmetry is realized in this picture and the conformal booster. So first, operator product expansion, very important tool. Okay, so in gauge theory, we know that gauge theory amplitudes, scattering amplitudes, develop singularities when two external particles become collinear. Okay, so these singularities, plus soft theorems, have been shown to be very important to actually getting at least at three level the full S matrix for gauge theories of gravity, for example, Einstein gravity. You can run the S matrix without Lagrangian mechanism, you can get the form of it just by studying the collinear limits and soft theorems, which will be coming soon. But collinearity, that means two particles travel in the same direction, because of this parametrization we have chosen, in the theory that we call celestial CFT, corresponds to Z1 approaches Z2. Remember that Z parameterizes the direction where the states travel asymptotically. So when two states become collinear, this corresponds to, actually, in the celestial CFT, two operators approach each other. So these singularities that you get from the collinear limit, somehow they should correspond to what we call OPE singularities, operator product expansion. So what's the operator product expansion? Just the product of two operators in a conformal field theory, two dimensions that I'm interested in, when they approach each other, can be approximated by an expansion in terms of local operators with some constants and some prefactors that can be singular. So here, this is singular here, when Zi approaches Zj, and the rest, what I have omitted here, is what we call regular terms, okay? And this singular behavior is extremely important because basically this pretty much allows you to determine almost completely CFT correlators in general for two dimensions. So if you know this structure constants here, which are specific to the theory you're discussing, this thing is fixed by conformal invariance. It depends on the conformal weights of these operators and the operator that they fuse to. So the CIJK is to tell you which operators fuse to give you which operators. That's what they tell you. And they give you a constant, a number for that. So if you have this information, in principle, you can construct conformal field theory correlators in two dimensions. So it's very important to understand what's happening in this picture. So let's see how do we see this story here. So we're going to start with Einstein-Young-Mills. I just chose Einstein-Young-Mills because you will see there's some novel features once you include gravity. Till now, I was discussing a bit gauge theory, very specifically. So take an Einstein-Young-Mills amplitude. These are gluons here. You have the situation where two gluons, they have a three-point function with a graviton, and this is the rest of the amplitude. So we just single two gluons, which they exchange a graviton with the rest of the amplitude here. There can be any number of states here, not all the states. So this whole factor here can be written as a propagator, the graviton propagator, and this three-point function, three-point vertex function, that tells you basically is a it's a standard Feynman diagram here. Now this here is called splitting function. And the important thing about this thing is the following. If these two gluons tend to be collinear, then you have a singularity in the propagator here, okay? So in that situation, it turns out that the amplitude, again, written, let's say, in spinor helicity notation, it factorizes. Factorizes to what? To some energy prefactor, some, let's say, 1/z bar. Well, depending whether Well, that depends here. I'm showing gravitons, so I should go here. So depending on what is the helicity of the graviton exchange, you get Z over Z bar actually, or Z bar over Z, some energy prefactors, and the remaining amplitude, it includes all the other particles and basically a new, let's say, graviton, either of plus plus helicity or minus minus, or plus two helicity or minus two helicity. And this is basically the behavior when Z approaches to Z bar. Now, for gravity, you see this is not singular, definitely. If you assume Z bar is complex conjugate of Z, definitely this is not singular, but if you assume that they are independent, like we usually do in conformal field theory, two dimensions, we take independent complex variables Z and Z bar, this is really a singular term. The same story, you have gluons exchanging a gluon with the rest of the amplitude, will give you terms like that, which are clearly singular, as Z bar goes to zero, Z bar 1, 2 goes to zero, or Z 1, 2 goes to zero. And we have these energy prefactors. But you see already kind of like something that looks like an OP. Two gluons, they fuse to give you a graviton in this situation, and some singular prefactor. Or two gluons fuse to give another gluon, which basically is this picture here, and you have a singular prefactor. So you need to take Mellin transform of this story here and see what you get. And if you do that carefully, it will turn out that this implies exactly what you expect, something that looks like an operator product expansion. For example, two opposite helicity gluons or opposite spin, now we're considering operators on the celestial CFD, they fuse to give you a new operator, okay, which have some singular behavior here. This C's here, the structure constants, and there are actually some beta functions, a beta function. Also, there include terms that involve the fusing of two, one plus one and minus one spin operators to give you an operator with spin minus two. That comes from the graviton, okay? And it has this type of behavior, which, as I said, it is singular if you consider as independent variables Z and Z bar, so complex, the two complex variables. So this was derived by using the collinear limits of four-dimensional Einstein-Yagmils, but what's very interesting, although I'm not gonna go into much detail about that, is that you writing a general answer of this type, you can figure out these constants here by applying only the symmetries of the theory that will be discussed soon, super translations. So this is actually quite interesting because usually a conformal field theory based on the Azoro symmetry or global conformal symmetry tells you, of course, what are the these factors here and the dimensions here, but they're not gonna tell you these constants here. So what this offers here was to apply some symmetries that we know that the theory possesses, specifically the extended BMS symmetry, and so that you can fix the form of these guys here without doing the Mellin transform. I can tell you that this is gonna be some specific beta function form. So let's look at the symmetries now. Let's see what we know and what is probably new. So at null infinity, as I said, BMS, Bondi, Mercer and Sachs found that there are more symmetries than what maybe we expected. So let's start with what we know. SL2C, it's of course for four dimensions, that's a SO1,3. In this picture, this is an SL2C symmetry that exists in a global conformal group. Also the Poincaré generators. In this Mellin picture, they correspond to operators that shift the dimensions of operators by plus one. So for example, here I wrote one combination, P0 plus P3, assume that this is the null direction. It's just P0 plus P3. And if you use this combination here, you can show that this basically acting on these Mellin amplitudes, which are the correlators, the CFD correlators, it corresponds to shift the dimensions by plus one. You can write similar expressions for the other combinations of the global conformal group. Okay, so that's fine, but now we come to the story that there's something more, okay? And I said before that we have super translations, and later on we found probably that there's more to that. So now you start again from four-dimensional picture, and you notice that back in quite some time ago, Weinberg had discussed what's called the soft theorem of, let's say, gravity or of gauge amplitude, where it turns out that when you take, let's start with gravity, you take a graviton that is energetically soft, very soft energetically, it turns out that an n plus one amplitude factorizes to an endpoint amplitude. You have a singular behavior that goes one over omega s. Omega s is the soft energy of the graviton, okay? And this here is an operator. It's just a prefactor that is universal. Its form is universal for any scattering process. It has the same form. It depends on the polarizations and momenta of the particles that are participating in here, but the standard form. It turns out later on, Cacciaso and Stromiger in 2014, they found out that if you continue this expansion, the energy expansion, not just the leading term, but you get also the sub-leading terms up to that point here, up to the sub-sub-leading, again, these factors here are universal. Anything beyond that is not, okay. And this kind of universality implies that there's some kind of symmetry. That's important, okay? It's not random. So these are called soft theorems. For gravity, this is going up to the sub-sub-leading. For gauge theory, you have a leading pole and a sub-leading, and everything after that is not universal. The same story for, let's say, photons or gluons. Okay, so now we said that usually what we do is to take Mellin transform of these things. So now we can try to take the Mellin transform of this behavior. I'm going to show you schematically what's happening. And it turns out that your Mellin amplitude, exactly because of this behavior, develops poles at specific dimensions that do not belong in this principal series 1 plus I lambda. They're separate integer dimensions. And therefore, there is some important role of these specific dimensions because they correspond to the energetically soft theorems. Okay. So let's see. Again, I write it again for gravity and for example, for gauge theory. Okay. And then if you write this thing carefully, for example, for Young-Mills, this is now I write the prefactor, this guy here, in terms of in terms of Spinor-Hilliste notation, but I use the Zs, obviously. And then eventually it turns out that the whole thing factorizes into this amplitude here, which of course you can take the Mellin transform and you will find the Mellin transform of this guy. And this guy right here, which actually includes the universal, the equivalent of this guy here in the celestial CFT and of this guy here in the celestial CFT. Well, after you take the Mellin transform, you need to take the Mellin transform. Okay, you need to take the Mellin transform of this guy. And basically we will come to the fact that these soft theorems here, energetically soft theorems, will give us conformally soft theorems. We call them conformally soft. I said they correspond to specific conformal dimension. Okay, and this will be interpreted as ward identities of symmetries of the celestial CFT. That's the idea. And these are ward, they correspond that once you take the Mellin transform of these guys, you get the ward identities of the symmetries of the celestial CFT. Well, let's see what's happening.
Sorry, could you clarify one thing?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So as I understood from the beginning, your amplitude is supposed to depend only on deltas, which are on the principal series. But now you are saying that these amplitudes, they have poles outside principal series.
That's correct.
Okay.
So that's correct. So the fact that you need to be in the principal series is a bit, it needs a bit more discussion. This form an orthonormal complete set of states, okay? You could have, for example, dimension 2 plus I lambda, but this would not be orthonormal. You can use the inverse Mellin transform to write any plane wave in terms of these guys, but they are not orthonormal, okay? And it has been discussed recently how you can write these dimensions, even n plus I lambda, in terms of course, since the 1 plus I lambda is complete, you can express any dimension 2 plus I lambda in this form. Now, there are these special dimensions that correspond to large gauge transformations if you look at the conformal primary wave function. So if you go to this if you go to this type of dimensions, for example, and you go back to the conformal primary wave functions that we discussed at the beginning, you will see that these are situations where the conformal primary wave function basically becomes a gauge transformation. Okay? It becomes a pure gauge transformation. So there are special cases, which of course then are associated with large gauge transformations at the asymptotic infinity of space-time. So indeed, for the standard radiative states that go out, you use the 1+I lambda. These are special here, okay? They're special. Mm-hmm. Does this answer your question?
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Okay, well, the first thing in a conformal free field is the energy momentum tensor. How do we get this thing? So we have a conformal soft graviton. Remember, this comes really from the subleading behavior of the graviton amplitudes. By doing the Mel transform, it turns out that this thing leads to a pole in the correlators when delta goes to zero. But of course, the energy momentum tensor in two dimensions is supposed to have dimension two and supposed to be holomorphic. So this is dimension zero and spin two. So it's not purely holomorphic, this operator that corresponds to this dimension. And it's has holomorphic and epiholomorphic. It's this guy here, okay? But the energy momentum tensor should have dimension two, let's say, the holomorphic one should be therefore an operator of 2, 0. So it turns out that we have some very nice transformation in conformal field theories. In two dimensions, you can do what we call the Sado transform. The Sado transform is just a change of basis. It's this type of transformation. You take an operator and integrate over the full over a full celestial sphere. And this new operator, if you start with an operator of dimension delta and spin j, what this Sado transform does is it gives you a new operator that has dimension 2 - delta, and the spin is flipped. It's -j. So this is exactly what we do. You can take the Mellin transform, the Sado transform of this operator, just look at the, we'll do that obviously at the amplitudes at the end of the day, but just look at now at the just the operator. And if you make the Sado transform of this guy here, it turns out that you get something that has dimension 2 and spin 2. So it has the right conformal weights to be named the energy momentum tensor. So how do we see that? Go to the actual amplitude. So take the full amplitude here. Okay. Make the Mellin transform and set dimension 0 for the one graviton, the one that we call soft. And it turns out that this Mellin amplitude implies this relation, that this insertion here in a string of other operators leads to this type of behavior, which of course you realize that this is the conformal word identity. Moreover, it's telling you, because you can extract the OP from here, that the OP of this guy with this primaries, again, we worked in gluons and gravitons only, so I keep saying that all the states we've been working are gluons and gravitons. So this thing implies this type of OP, which is telling you that these guys are not just global conformal primaries, but they're actually Virasoro primaries. Okay, this is what you expect if this is a Virasoro primary. So what is happening is that we have identified an operator that behaves just like the energy momentum tensor. Now the next thing you want to do is to see the algebra. So if this is generates conformal transformations, what is the algebra? So now you need to take double soft limits. So basically going back, here we took one graviton to be soft, let's take two of them soft and repeat the same story. It's a bit technically involved, all the story here. Let me be checking also, I'm sorry, I need to be checking my time. Yeah, of course. So the story here is the following, that you repeat this thing here for two gravitons, and you find out this type of behavior, which of course exactly what you expect from Virasoro algebra. I mean, I'm sorry, this is exactly what you expect for the energy momentum tensor of the two-dimensional conformal field theory, with a central charge zero. You find out that the two holomorphic produce this one, T and T bar, because you can define obviously an anti-holomorphic if you use the graviton that has J is equal plus two and you take the Sato transform, you will get the J minus two here. And you find out what you expect. Now, we said though that we have some other symmetries. I mentioned at the beginning super translations. So what are these guys? Well, these things correspond to generalizations of the Poincaré in asymptotic theory. And here, let's see what they do in the celestial CFD. One of them I showed to you, it does shift the dimensions of operators. So you can define again using now the dimension one soft, conformally soft graviton. That's the first one here from this theorem here. And you can construct this operator P here, which once you do the same story, you find out that it produces, it looks like a current. It acts almost like a current of the conformal primaries, on the primary conformal primaries. Okay, but it does hit the dimension by plus one. And of course you can take, well, you see that this is a derivative of a primary. So it is actually a descendant, an anti-holomorphic descendant. So you can compute for this guy, the check what is the transformation properties under conformal transformations. On the holomorphic side, it transforms like a primary, on the anti-holomorphic as a descendant, as it should. And this generates the transformation. That is what we call super translation. Now, let's write the algebra of the generators of the symmetries. We take the conformal, the energy momentum tension, we expand in terms of Virasoro. We can take any primary field that expanded in terms of modes. The translation operators, the four of them, are the one I had written before, and these are the other three combinations. You see they have some dependence on the Z and Z bar, that means on the direction of the celestial sphere. This is what we had before, and we said when this acts on a primary, it shifts the dimension by plus one. On the modes, if you expand a primary field in modes, just like you do in standard CFD, it's gonna lead to these shifts on the mode expansion. And now you wanna do the algebra. All right, so you need to define, as we will see, going back to what, well, we were expecting that because we knew what was the BMS algebra, okay? So you can define these operators here, these generators. It's an infinite number of them. So you start with the basic one, the P, this notation minus one half has to do with the paper that we use as a basis, a paper by Barnick that uses this type of mode expansion that starts from minus one half. But remember, this is just the one that shifts the dimensions. You can take commutators with the energy momentum tensor and construct these guys here. And if you act with these guys on a primary, it turns out that what these guys do is to shift the dimensions of the primary, but in an angle dependent manner. It depends on the direction. Okay, so they shift the dimension, but they have an angle dependent part. This is exactly what we call supertranslations. Supertranslations, they correspond in the space-time picture into angle dependent shifts of the coordinate u, the null coordinate. Now here we don't have u, the null coordinate, but we have conformal weights h, and they get shifted. So the algebra that you get is at the end, Virasoro, which I have not written down, with zero conformal charge. And now you have what? You have these operators, the generators of supertranslations. Okay. And they give you exactly what you expected. Between them, they commute. And with the energy, with the Virasoro, they don't commute, but they get this type of algebra. In general, Barnick and Rosan had discussed the possibility of having some field dependent quantities, but we find zero here. Of course, we're working at three level amplitudes, and at least at this level, we, that we work on with this scattering amplitudes, these are zero here. So we've ended BMS. Okay, I have not written the Virasoro all the way down. So we started with conformals of theorems. We found what operators would correspond, of course, to symmetries. And then we did the mod expansion of these generators of these symmetries, and we found the extended BMS algebra. So what we have, global BMS symmetry of celestial sphere, just a recap, generated by the SL2R, the global part of the conformal group, okay? We had the Poincaré, standard Poincaré. And then we said, okay, look, just as has been predicted by BMS, this global conformal transformations, they become local. This is the Virasoro here. And the space-time translations, they become also local. Remember these guys here, they produce local angle-dependent shifts of the operator. So we found the extended BMS algebra. Now, not gonna go into details about supersymmetry. You can do the same thing with supersymmetry. I'm just gonna show quickly just to have for completeness. And then I'm gonna move in the remaining 10 minutes that I have on discussing now. We said how we got the algebra. We want to discuss a bit more the amplitudes to do this conformal block decomposition. So you can go to supersymmetry now. You can discuss the same thing, the same way you have scalar conformal primary wave functions, you have fermionic ones, okay? And then you can take, for example, the expand any field, bosonic or fermionic in terms of oscillators. By set of oscillators being, usually you make an expansion in terms of plane waves. Here you can make an expansion in terms of conformal primary wave functions. You get this type of oscillators that create specific operators, specific dimension and spin on the celestial sphere. That's the holographic picture. These are the bulk fields. You just expand them, you do expansion in terms of oscillators. And this is a bit more technical, but the idea is that at the end of the day, you find out that if you have supersymmetry, what supersymmetry translates from space-time, so you can take the, let's say you have a chiral multiple, you can take a supersymmetry transformation of a scalar and connect it to the fermionic and vice versa, you can construct a multiplet, a chiral multiplet, and the same thing you can do, construct a gauge multiplet, etc., on cell everything. And then at the end of the day, you can write down what is the action of supersymmetry on these operators. The same ones you had, but now you have fermionic operators. Now I use this J, C, and J, and that's why I went through the slides, because basically what these operators do is that obviously they need to change the statistics, so they need to change the spin. So if you are, let's say, at, you have a zero, if you are in the chiral multiple, then this J is zero. When a supersymmetry operator acts on it, it's going to lead you to a minus one half spin operator on the celestial sphere, and it's gonna shift the dimension by one half. Okay, so supersymmetry, you can realize supersymmetry also. Which, the very interesting thing is, of course, you can define supercharge, the same thing you did about the energy momentum tensor. You can use fermionics of theorems. There are fermionics of theorems exactly like we have for the bosonic ones. And then you can construct from these conformally soft fermionic states by Sado some purely holomorphic or purely holomorphic supercurrents. Okay. And you can mod expand the supercurrents. The zero modes of these currents correspond to the supersymmetries, the standard, the four-dimensional supersymmetries, but there are more modes. So again, just like we did for translations, translations went to become super translations. Now, let's say we have super fermionic operators. And that's what I want to say. The algebra now that you get is, of course, I didn't write down the Virasoro part, but it's quite more interesting. These are the fermionic generators. Now, you don't get superconformal symmetry. And let me explain. If you had superconformal symmetry, this G and G bar here, they should anticommute. That should have been zero. On the other hand, G and G, So two same holomorphic, the generators of the holomorphic supersymmetry transformations, let's say on the word set we are discussing in the theory, should close on the Virasoro. So GG closes normally in the Virasoro, but here they don't. Okay, so the algebra you get when you put supersymmetry is not superconformal symmetry. That's what I wanted just to say. And of course, you can expand this is an n equals one supersymmetry algebra. Supersymmetric extension of the BMS algebra, but you can go to n equals four, it was done recently. So you get another algebra here, which has fermionic operators. It does realize the, it has one that is due to the fermionics of the arms, but it doesn't, it's not a superconformal algebra. It was good. Okay, so now let me go to the end of my topics. Okay, I have a bit of time just to say a few things. Again, that's supposed to be a 1 hour and then more questions. Is that correct, Dimitri?
Yes, 15 minutes for questions, but you can go ahead. Yeah, it's not too long.
Yeah, I mean, I think I'll be done in 10 minutes. Maybe I'll go 5 minutes over time.
Mm-hmm, no problem.
So, having done OPEs, having discussed wired identities, some other things that one would like to do is to discuss now conformal bootstrap. So, in other words, you want to check conformal bootstrap is associativity of the OP. It tells you that if I give you, let's say, a four-point function, you can use the operator product expansion between two operators to construct this four-point function. And but then you should be able to do, let's say, if you do operator one and two, OP, and you get the four-point function, you should be able to do OP between two and three and get the same thing. In order to proceed through that, the first thing one needs to do is to discuss what's called usually regular quantization. So you try to construct states in the CFT, okay, in and out states. And the question is, what's the Hermitian conjugate of an operator? I'm just considering here a general operator. Okay. The usual story is, it's called the BPZ story. Is that the Hermitian conjugate on this guy here. So you put, actually, you want to put, if you want to describe, let's say, the two-point function, you want to put one operator, so you conformally map. Usually you start by having a cylinder, time minus infinite, time plus infinite, the one side of the cylinder. And then you conformally map this thing on a sphere, and you want to put one state at the south pole, the other at the north pole, okay? And this is what you want to compute is the inner product. Okay, in standard CFT, the Hermitian conjugate, the one that, that the operator that gives you the out state, so if the in state is in the south pole, you want to put in the north pole, the other one, is given by this prescription here. And then basically, by conformal invariance, you know that the you can just run to the steps as standard textbook steps. Okay, you put one operator as z is equal to zero, the other you want to put as z goes to infinity. Okay, and then that implies this type of two-point function, which is exactly what you expect. Conformal invariance tells you that the two-point function should have this form. Okay, and this constant c is just basically the normalization constant. That's what you usually do. Here, though, we have a problem with the celestial sphere, and this will motivate why I will do the, what I'm going to do. And the celestial sphere, this is a story that I was saying before, you can have some states coming in, and then some states that are coming out. The important thing is that the celestial sphere of the past, because these things are coming from a celestial sphere in the past, and they got, these are celestial sphere in the future. If you want to map them, you want to glue the two spheres with an antipodal identification, you antipodally identify points. And this leads to the following two-point function between two operators. They have a delta function here. So it's telling you, normally in a sphere, you would expect this comes in from the south, exits, let's say, from the north pole at the diametric. But because it's an antipodal identification, this point where this operator enters is mapped to the same point that the other exits. That's why you have this delta function here. And therefore, this is not convenient. Moreover, you can check that the Virasoro generators don't, I mean, let's stick with the global conformal, forget Virajoro for the time being, you can use the Klein-Gordon inner product for space-time fields, and you can find out that this type of behavior leads to the following, that the adjoint of this generator here you can put n is equal minus 1, 0, or 1, the global one, is minus L bar. This is not what you would expect in a CFT. In a CFT, you expect, I think I wrote it before, you expect L dagger to be L minus N, not L dagger to be minus L bar N. So that's a problem. So what you do here, a trick that you can do, is to bring this Sato transform again into the picture. So what you do, instead of saying that the out states are created by just the standard dagger of the original field, the BPZ, you do BPZ prescription, but with a Sato transform. Convolution with the Sato transform. And now this is quite interesting, because if you use the Sato transform, so you take basically the operator phi has a complex conjugate, a Hermitian conjugate, which is a phi tilde, which is a Sato one. So if you use this picture, you recover the correct two-point function. And the inner product is what you expect, is what I wrote in the previous slide. You get exactly this thing. Okay. So that is telling you that it might be, and of course now you get the adjoints of the conformal algebra and exactly what you would expect standard. The L dagger N is L minus N. Okay, I'm talking about global. For time, I don't do Virajoro yet because it turns out that the Sato for operators that are not soft, you do it, it's a bit difficult. The Virajoro symmetry, there. This type of transformation is covariant under global conformal transformation, but not under local. So it needs some work here, but let's just stick to the global one for the time being. So we define this type of radial quantization prescription. Okay. So that implies now something, that if we want to do some story like that here, the most sensible thing would be to try to take, if we have a scattering of four-point function, like two in and two out, then everything would be, okay, let's take the two in and saddle them. So these are the two in states, and the two out will be non-saddle. This is a bit technically complex. So now we're doing something a bit simpler. We did saddle one of the operators out of the four-point function. So you can go back to the four-point function of four gluons, the one that we got from the Mellin transform of the scattering amplitude, the MHP amplitude. And what you can do, well, you can do some fixing, that's standard. You will do some fixing of, you use the Möbius invariance to fix one point at zero, one at one, another one at infinity. And then the third point here, it's at the this X here, which is the conformal cross ratio. So you do it, again, fixing just for convenience. And in generally you expect, so you take our Mellin amplitude, you do some gauge fixing, you expect that this thing will be written in a form like that. Some structure constants, these coefficients are the structure constants of the three-point function, of the OPEs between operator 1, 2, and 3, 4, the ones of the OPE, and some what we call conformal blocks here, which of course, if you have a theory that is like two dimensions, you have a holomorphic and a holomorphic. And the picture looks something like that. Okay, so this describes, of course, the fusion of two operators, one and two, give you an intermediate operator with conformal, a primary with H and H bar, and then they give you a 3-4. The conformal blocks include, by conformal symmetry, global, let's say, global, forget the Virajoro for the time being, it allows you to know exactly the full expression with all descendants also running in between. So once you know the structure constant and the form of the coupling for the primary, then you can you have the full, this includes all the descendant contributors as well. Descendants are constructed by acting with the L minus one on the Virajoro, the global conformal generator L minus one on the primary. And in general, we know from the work of Dolan and Osborne that these conformal blocks take this form. Okay. Oh, well, we're done. They take this form. This is hypergeometric functions. And these are depends on the conformal dimensions, the conformal weights of the parameters. So you expect something like that. And indeed, without going through a full set of story here, we do the story here exactly. We compute, as I said, the saddle. We do a saddle transform of one of the states. And the reason why we do it, one of the main reasons, is that remember that the four-point function had a delta function that always kind of unnatural on a CFT. It has delta of z minus z bar. By doing a saddle transform, you get rid of that and you get a normal polynomial function, something like that, a polynomial. You get a normal function that doesn't have distributions. So then, for simplicity, we also take this one of the states to be soft. That's for simplicity because things are quite complicated here. And then, basically, I'm sorry, this is the four-point function. It has two terms because there are two color factors that can contribute. Okay. And the full thing here, these are some integrals here. And depending on which space-time channel you have chosen, if you're doing 1, 2 goes to 3, 4, or 1, 3 goes to 2, 4, you have different integrals. But the interesting thing is that these integrals can indeed be written in terms of conformal blocks. So these expressions here that you get, you can write in terms of conformal blocks. So it turns out that the full four-point function can be factorized in a form that you would expect for a conformal free theory four-point function. You have some constants. These are color factors here. And you have the conformal blocks. So basically, all these guys here that you got from the integrals, these I integrals here, you can write them as some of conformal blocks of different primaries. And you see that you don't have just primaries with dimension one. Actually, you don't even get them. And that probably goes to the question that you asked before. The three-point function of three gluons is zero. So naively, you would say the four-point function, if you follow the story, should be zero. But you see now that we get conformal primaries, so we get blocks of conformal primaries that have dimensions 2 plus m plus I lambda, and spins which are more than one. So you get new operators. So definitely, they're not gluons that mediate. And that answers your question probably. There are no gluons that mediate here. There are other operators that need to be included in the theory, and one needs to study them very carefully. They have different dimensions and higher spins. Okay, and I'm done, basically. So the next thing you would like to do is to do crossing symmetry, and crossing symmetry tells you, okay, you went and expanded this thing around x is equal to zero, which means you expand around the channel where 1, 2 fuses to give something and then becomes 3, 4. But you should be able to do the other way around, go 2 approaches 3, etc. And that corresponds to the question whether this thing is the same as, be careful the order here, you need to compute the correlator with a different gauge fixing here, 1/x and 1/x bar. But now you're running a problem. If you take these functions that I found before and you analytically continue, this is a function that this is the t-channel, space-time t-channel, has 1/x, so it has a good expansion if x is bigger than 1. It has a serious expansion. But if you make analytic continuation of this thing for x smaller than 1, you will get some terms like these ones that lead actually to operators that have imaginary spins. Okay, which tells you that it's not single valued. So we have found a four-point function that as long as you restrict the x, which is the cross ratio, the specific region, it has a good expansion. But if you are trying to analytically continue, which is exactly what you need to do in order to do the crossing symmetry, you analytically continue outside the region, you get imaginary spin state. So definitely that is telling you that what we call conformal bootstrap here, which would be exactly this relation here, it needs a lot more thinking, and we are working on various things. One thing is that if you were going to go to 2,2 signature, you have what we call light ray operators, which indeed they do exist in that signature, and they do have spins that are matched, right? So, but if you stick in your standard 1.3, which has what we call is the celestial sphere, the Euclidean celestial sphere, these things are unacceptable. So what's happening with the crossing symmetry is a big story. Okay, and you could take another, you could do the same story for lambda 1, not 0, but it's not particularly intuitive. So what you would like to do, and I'm done. Well, the important thing without going into too much story is, okay, quantum level, I've been working three level. What is happening? I said about soft theorems, I kept saying the leading graviton and the subleading graviton. I never discussed the sub-subleading graviton theorem. That is because this is not known if it survives when you take into account loop corrections. So one is to understand what's happening at the quantum level. That's one thing. And the other thing that I'm particularly interested, I think, is the one that I've been discussing, is the crossing symmetry. And there are many other things to discuss. What's happening with string theories? What is the high energy limit of string theory? Like the stringy celestial CFT, start from string amplitudes. Quite interesting things to do. And how to relate the story to standard holography. Standard holography uses Witten diagrams between ADS, some ADS. So you can slice your Minkowski space in ADS3 slices. And you can try to see how you can do standard CFT in the story. Holography picture in the story. So these are various things, various directions, but for me, the most interesting right now is to understand the crossing symmetry. What is happening with the crossing symmetry? And I'm gonna stop here. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for a nice talk. Are there any questions?
Yeah, I have a question. As far as I understand, what you told mostly concerns three level amplitudes, all right?
Mm-hmm.
And already for the four particle amplitude, you got this expression via conformal blocks. And it's quite complicated, but what you could tell about multi-loop diagrams amplitudes and whether they could be computed from this?
To my knowledge, what has been computed, I know one loop, is the Mellon transform of one loop and higher loops of a 5-4 theory. But this is probably not what we want to do. So what's happening at loop level, we do not know except from the infrared. Okay, so there's been quite some work about how amplitudes, that I think it's probably known, you know the BDS story that you can factorize any scattering process between a hard part and the infrared soft part, which are dressings, let's say, of the states that are scattering. That's in four dimensions. And that has been done already in the celestial CFT similar story. It's been actually a couple of papers back in 2000, in December by Arcani and Strominger and one just even yesterday, quite interesting. So the infrared loops, they can be actually, it turns out that the infrared story, at least loops from the infrared, they seem to correspond, can be absorbed into shifts of the dimensions by terms that depend on the anomalous cusp dimension.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah. So the infrared, at least to some level, has been worked out. For the UV, I really do not know. It has not been accepted by one group that did, I told you, the 5-4 theory. Which of course, I think was kind of trivial because everything was just a prefactor. What I can tell you is that, for example, there's some quite nice stuff, for example, string theory. I didn't have time to discuss it here. It has an alpha prime. When you do the Mellon transform of a string amplitude, this alpha prime factorizes as a prefactor. It becomes alpha prime to some power that depends on the dimensions. So I think the story probably will remain at higher loops. So probably we have, of course, a cutoff, a UV cutoff, but it will probably be factorized in front, and the rest will be a correlator that has the conformal properties that we expect. But again, this is, okay, I cannot say much because really people have concentrated on the three level and the infrared, okay? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Other questions?
Just maybe short question. I was a bit lost towards the end. You said something that in the exchange you find some states that you wouldn't expect to find, for example, higher spin states and so on. Could you please comment a bit more?
Yeah. So here is another story. Let me go back. How can I go back? Okay. So normally we start, we have only gluons and gravitons, and this belong in the principal series. We find blocks that have J is equal M, where M is bigger than zero. We find all these bunch of blocks here. Okay. Now, two things. We are doing global conformal expansion. We're expanding in global conformal blocks, not Virasoro, okay? Because we know the expression of global conformal blocks is definitely hypergeometric. With Virasoro, we don't know them in general. So one thing one would say, you know, like any descendant of Virasoro generators, like L minus two, L minus three descendants, you can write combinations of them that are global conformal primaries. Okay, so one naive thing would be like that these guys could be Virasoro descendants. But of course, so basically the modules of the local conformal group, you can decompose them into global conformal, okay? But that's not very probable. So where could they come from? For the spin, I'm not 100% sure, but these guys here, they can come from supertranslations. I told you that supertranslations shift the dimensions by plus one. So if you start with standard gluons, if a supertranslation acts, it's gonna give you a 2 plus I lambda, a 3 plus I lambda. Now the spin is a bit more tricky. How would you go up in spins if you don't use Virasoro generators or something else? So this we do not know exactly, but there is some story that came in the past few months. Except from the standard conformal primary wave functions, it seems that there are what they call generalized conformal primary wave functions. That is discussed by Pastersky and Poom and other collaborators. So there are more primaries, which of course are not related to the what we call radiative gluons. The gluons that radiate at infinity or gravitons are gonna be just 1 plus I lambda. But it seems that you can write more general solutions that do not correspond to these gluons or gravitons that have different spins. They are higher spins. Not the typical higher spins that you're talking, that I have probably in mind. I don't know, but in general, you could have the states there. So they exist, but they will not be states that reach the asymptotic boundary, okay? Their nature is unclear because here we can see all the conformal block. If I assume that they are those described recently by Pastersky and Poom, then we have a specific form. You can check it out in their papers. They correspond to specific conformal primary wave functions, just like what I wrote before, but with higher spins, higher spin construction. I mean, what I wrote somewhere at the beginning, just to see. So they are typical, as if you look at them as wave functions, if I'm not mistaken, oh, get stuck a bit. Just give me a second because the computer is a bit slow. And there will be things like that, but with more polarization tensors here. Okay. So they seem that you need to have them for a conformal block decomposition. They don't seem to be Virasoro descendants. But it's not clear yet if they correspond to this operator, these states that were described recently by these authors. So that's all I can tell you at this point.
Okay, many thanks.
So I don't know, maybe it's wrong, but it reminds me, you know how it works in usual ADS CFT, mm-hmm. where like you have a 4-point correlator and it has a single trace conformal block contributions, but it also has like many double trace conformal block contributions, which have like higher dimensions and they can have any spin. And on the block side, it corresponds like you have an exchange and has a singular part which corresponds to single trace blocks. But then you have also like contributions from double trace operators, which are not associated with any singularities in any on-shell fields.
Yeah, I know. I would, I don't know if I can say the same thing here. No, I know what you mean, because that would be, but these ones usually, there's a weak strong, you notice that this holographic picture is not weak strong, eh? So.
Yeah, but here what I'm saying is not like weak strong, it's purely kinematic. You just have like, you can expand everything into conformal blocks, classify it into whether it's something a single trace or a double trace.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know what you mean.
Yeah, but maybe the usual idea of CFT, it's based on matrix theory, where this it and large N. So here there is completely different story, right?
I think it's different.
Parameters don't really play any role. It's purely kinematical. So
yes.
But maybe the question is, what are the multiparticle states? So, but probably that doesn't make sense from a matrix point of view.
Say it again, what are they, what?
You can, this single trace, double trace has interpretation of also looking at multiparticle states rather than.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, that's what I, so what would be the meaning here? Because that we started, because that's what I was thinking, that there, and I said weak strong because I was thinking, of course, globals, because when you have strong interactions and you have composite operators of two together, right? So here, at this perturbative level, they show up, I don't know. Of course, there's the other idea that it's not obvious how much sense we can make purely from tree level, because you see, metal transform takes an integral of energies from zero to infinity, right? So, working with three-level amplitudes, but for example, and that probably might be closer to what it would be a resolution, let's say, to what you said. The story of the last paper of Arkani, Hamed, and Strominger is that we should look at the theory as an effective field theory, you know? And then, of course, if you look at this effective field theory, I guess you could have higher order operators, right? And then, of course, you can include them. So in principle, you expect poles at higher spins if you look at the theory as an effective field theory. So it's not obvious that you can just work with three level. And we're working on three level, right? But I mean, you were integrating energies from zero to infinity. The fullest matrix, we have to include all loops, everything. So I would say that, I'm not clear what this, this is one of the things that we're trying to understand. What are these operators? Where do they come from? And I think the way to understand it would be really by doing to understand some of the properties would be by doing the crossing symmetry. So we have space-time crossing symmetry. Like let's say 1, 2 goes to 3, 4, you can cross 1 and 3. Yeah, that's a space-time crossing symmetry. And the idea would be, what does this thing mean in terms of standard CFT crossing symmetry, which is the OPE associativity? Take the OPE first of 1, 2, put it in the remaining stuff, you find something, or you take the OPE between 2 and 3 and then insert it and see what you get. And somehow these two are related, and I think that one will give you some consistency constraints between these operators, either in one OP channel and the other OP channel. So that should probably reveal some of the properties of these operators. And then how is this connected to crossing symmetry, space-time crossing symmetry? That will be the final step and probably the most interesting. And we hope that we can get some idea from there. Now, so that's one story that could go that way. The other thing is, so one is the perception of the effective field theory plus where I just told you how to reveal maybe some of these features. The next story is the 2.2. Okay. In standard four-dimensional physics, all this BCFW, we are doing this in 2.2 signature. We do complex momentum. Okay. So what has been already discussed a bit recently, just 2021, is that probably maybe one is to consider the theory really on 2.2 signature. 2.2 signature means that you don't have a celestial sphere, but you have what's called a celestial torus. Okay. It's different than the geometry. Then Z and Z bar are not complex conjugate to another, but they are independent real variables. And they parameterize a torus, what's called a celestial torus. And there you do have higher spin states, you have imaginary spins, okay, the things that we find here when we try to do cross symmetry. And you have dimensions also more than that. So it's a different formulation of the theory. My understanding is just like in the standard four-dimensional physics, you work in 2.2, right? You compute BCFW various amplitudes. You get a whole of things that don't make sense, but if you combine them together, you get the correct four-point amplitude with the correct poles, right? Okay. So that could be probably the story even here. Maybe you need to go to 2.2. You're going to find these funny states with even imaginary spins, higher spins like Jenny was asking. Okay. There are there. If you put super translations, you will find higher dimensions and higher spins. You will get that. You compute correlators there. You combine them just like you do in BCFW in a specific way. You get the four-point correlator of the 1.3 theory. That's another possibility. So maybe the correct way to see it is through the celestial torus.
I have a very naive question. So is this so four dimensions are presumably very special because you do get two dimensional.
Say it again?
Yeah, it's conformal symmetry. Was there any discussion of three or five dimensional? So you can consider massless scattering, say, in three dimensions or five dimensions. So in this case, you will not have infinite dimensional symmetry, naively, but actually from, yeah, well, that's my question. Was there any discussion of something similar?
So similar, yeah.
Similar in high or lower dimensions.
Yeah. In lower, in three, there is.
Yeah.
There is. There's the BMS3. Yeah, that has been done. And this, it seems you can also work on ABS3 and you can find a similar story. And then you can get to this BMS3 by a flat space limit of the ABS3.
Okay.
For higher dimensions, that's a good question. I think there is something, but I have to check. But for lower, there is. There's a BMS, the three dimensional BMS. Yeah.
Okay.
Higher, I'm not sure. Don't remember actually. Yeah.
Okay, I have like the last question probably. Do you have like any ideas on the possibility to have some kind of field theoretic description of what's going on the boundary, like we have in ADS-18, the usual one? Like local field theory with Lagrangian, which
A sigma model. Good. That would be great. If we had a sigma model, we'd solve everything. So there is actually the infrared effects. They can be described by operators that are like typical, like tachyon type operators of string theory, exponential I-phi. So there is some kind of recent work where you can see, for example, these infrared dressings that I discussed, okay? Arising from some kind of standard CFT. Like you have some scalars, which actually they correspond to the Goldstone modes of the symmetries that are discussed, by the way, they're spontaneously broken. With exception of Lorentz, which is L2C, and the normal translations, everything else is spontaneously broken by the emission of soft particles. Okay, so there are some Goldstone modes, and you can use these Goldstone modes to construct indeed these dressings, okay? And you use them pretty much a standard way of a CFT, okay? So I would say for the soft modes, because these are related to soft theory, right? There seems to be emerging a picture like that. okay, which I think very recently, just last week again, Pastersky, Boom, and Trevisiani, they came up with a paper. They had a kind of like a sigma model type, higher derivative though, sigma model type description of the soft modes, right? But the full theory, I don't know how. But that would be, yeah, naively, that would be the story. I don't know if string theory could help a bit more on that for various reasons. For example, you take the string theory amplitudes, the Mellin transform of them, you can ask, so something else that has a glimpse of something that looks like that. You want to take the alpha prime goes to infinity limit, but not only the alpha prime factorizes in front. So what does it mean alpha prime goes to infinity limit, which is naively something that you would do the gross Mendes story of high energy scattering in string theory. It turns out that you can take the limit where there's an equivalent limit that you use this conformal dimensions and you shift them to infinity. Because at all in string theory, there's no delta function that constrains the conformal dimensions. Okay, this delta function that tells you delta 1 plus delta 2 plus delta 3 plus delta 4 minus 4 is equal to 0, it's not there. So you can take some specific limit of this parameter, and then it kind of emerges a story like that, like the celestial sphere becomes a worksheet of operators. That was described a bit by, but was not pursued further by Steenberger and Taylor back in 2018. So in that basically limit, maybe there is some kind of, you know, like a sigma model description. Or the soft modes, as I told you, the recent story is that there might be something. And there were two papers I told you for the soft modes. One paper that also discussed a similar story is the one by Lorenzo Manea also, okay? And of course the papers by Strominger and so the kind of like there is seems to be a sigma model or some kind of two-dimensional CFT for the software at least.
So they actually look like fields on the boundary, right? In the CFT tool.
And again?
So they actually look like fields on the boundary, like in the CFT tool, with some kind of box phi equations of motion.
Yeah, right? Anyway, that's the point. I don't think they have box phi. I think they have higher derivatives. So it's a bit different. Yeah, I just take a look at the last paper of Pastersky. It's not boxed. That's the point. This has to do with the fact that it turns out, and again, they describe some soft modes. You remember they're not dimensions one plus I lambda. They're integer dimensions. Okay, and for integer dimensions, for example, in standard CFT, you know you have null states. You can act with Virasoro, construct some combinations that are called null state. Now, if you have dimensions bigger than zero, you cannot do that with just L minus one. You need L minus two. You need the Virasoro. You cannot do it just with the global. But if you allow dimensions that are negative, because all these soft theorems start from delta is equal zero, then you have delta minus one, you can have even other negative deltas, which they correspond to some kind of soft operators on the CFT. It is how you can construct null states by acting with L minus one, basically by derivatives. If you take a number of derivatives on these conformal primary wave functions of these operators, you're gonna get zero at one point. And therefore that's why the model they write is not exactly a box one. It's a model that incorporates the fact that if you act with a number of derivatives on these fields, you're supposed to get zero at the end. Okay, so the modules truncate. But this is for these special soft operators. Okay, for the special soft operators. So the soft sector seems to have something what you proposed. Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Well,
any other questions? Okay, then thanks again for a nice talk, for a good explanation.
Thank you very much for the invitation.
Thank you.
And have a good
day.
Very nice night. Thank you, Mas.